Have you ever wondered what a caveman mullet looks like? Or are you a normal, well-adjusted human being? Clearly not, because you came to this talk, and I appreciate that. But even if you don't go down these weird rabbit holes, I'm sure that we've all looked into the mirror at our hair and thought, what is this? But tonight, I want to encourage you to unleash your inner evolutionary detective and ask, seriously, what is this? We're going to go on an epic adventure. It's going to start with asking why it was so important for our ancestors to keep cool, and it's going to end with, of course, robots. Now, you may be wondering, who is this dapper young scientist in front of you? Well, I am currently a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Southern California, where I work on, thank you, projects on population genetics. And I do things from understanding the likelihood of finding a distant relative in a genetic database, all the way to looking at genetics to understand complex traits like skin and, of course, hair. But how this all really began is when I was an undergrad at Cambridge University in England. That is where I started studying biological anthropology. And that's really the study of what it means to be human. Now, what I really love about doing research in biological anthropology is that I get to think not only about how different traits work, I get to ask why they evolved. You see, nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. Put more simply, what was the reason for the evolution of various traits, including hair? And that is our quest tonight. That is our million-dollar question. Why do humans have hair on their heads? Our journey begins long ago, at least 164 million years ago. That is when we find some of the oldest impressions of hair on skin that we can attribute to a mammal. Now, what's interesting about that is, just like feathers predate birds, hair likely predates mammals. Now, we don't really know what the function was of those early hairs in those not-quite-mammals, but we know quite a bit about the functions of hair in today's mammals. We know that it can help with physical protection. It can stop from abrasion to the skin. We know that it can do a thing or two for camouflage if you pick the right fur coat. And it can also communicate things. What you see right here are some really cute langurs, and they're this neutral dark gray color when they grow up, but they start out bright orange. So that can tell you, I'm a baby. And of course, thermoregulation. We know that a fur coat, whether store-bought or homegrown, can keep you warm. And while all of these functions are interesting, we're gonna focus on that last one today. So, let's fast forward to about 2 million years ago. Imagine you are a Homo erectus gallivanting across East Africa with your newly evolved long limbs, and you are incredibly efficient at walking. Maybe you can even break into a little jog. You can cover a good distance. But the thing is, just because you can do something doesn't mean that it's easy. And the thing about being a biped and one that is active is that you generate heat. And when you combine that with a hot, arid environment, especially one that has a lot of solar radiation, things can get a little too toasty. And that is why we believe that around this time, our human lineage likely lost its body hair and grew a lot more high density of eccrine sweat glands. Now, if we want to get really technical, we didn't lose our body hair, we just miniaturized those hair follicles. But it is important to have naked skin so that you can sweat and evaporate that sweat efficiently. But I thought this was a talk about hair, so why am I talking about the benefits of losing it? Well, here's the plot twist. Hair can actually keep you cool. So you see, if radiation comes down on the skin, and there is a nice layer of hair there, some of that radiation will get reflected before it reaches the skin, and some of that radiation will even get absorbed in the hairs instead of the skin. So that's a pretty good deal. And that is why there are some studies that show that there are mammals out there, especially some types of squirrels and kangaroos, that have very thick coats, even though they live in very sunny places. And that's because the thicker the coat is, the more the distance is between the top of the hair and the top of the skin, which can be pretty helpful. So, from what we've learned so far, our ancestors lost their body hair so they could keep cool, but our ancestors also kept some of their hair so they could stay cool. Why would we have two solutions for seemingly one problem? That has to do with us being bipedal. You see, an animal that stays upright gets the brunt of the solar radiation on its head. And when you decide to add a large, heat-sensitive brain to the mix, you can see how our ancestors might have faced a unique set of challenges. And that unique set of challenges might explain why we are the only weirdos who couldn't commit to being fully naked or fully hairy, but decided to go with the combo meal. Here's another special thing about us humans. We are very diverse, especially when it comes to the hair. There are a lot of different hair textures. We have everything from stick straight hair to tightly coiled hair. We've got it all. But let's talk about curly hair for a second. This is a uniquely human trait. I love to point out to people, have you ever noticed that most mammals have straight hair? And I often ask, do you know any mammals that have curly hair? And people will say, what about poodles? I myself have a poodle. But they're not really curly, and the curls are nowhere near what we see in humans. Also, they're domesticated, and if you know dog breeds, you know we've done a lot of funny things to them. So let's restrict it to somewhat more naturally occurring animals. A lot of people will say, what about sheep? Surprise, sheep do not have curls. We actually know a lot about sheep's wool, and sheep's wool is crimped. It has a bilateral wave, so a wave that goes up and down. Now, you might think that I'm nitpicking here, because you got to nitpick to do a PhD, right? But no, it's actually really structurally important, because you see, when you have this nice, neat bilateral wave, you can stack a lot of fibers next to each other. And when you stack fibers next to each other in this super neat way, it means there's not a lot of airspace between them. On the other hand, if you've seen human curls, they can be pretty chaotic. Now, that chaos is good because that means that there's a lot of airspace. And basically, you can maximize the distance between the scalp and the top of the hair without packing on a dense amount of fur. But whenever we see anything in nature that is unique in a species, we really have to pause and ask, why? What is so special about this species that evolution had to come up with a brand new solution when nothing else worked out of the box? Well, knowing that our ancestors were these bipeds who had these large brains, we're gonna run with that. A unique thermoregulatory challenge, a unique challenge of keeping a precise body temperature relating to having this big brain, and maybe not wanting to activate this sweat response. We'll get back to sweat later on. We have enough burning questions now that we can put something to the test. Our hypothesis is that humans evolved scalp hair as a thermoregulatory adaptation. So, as a solution to regulate our body temperature, and specifically to stop from overheating. Our main question is, does scalp hair protect us from solar heat gain? And one of our sub-questions is, do different hair textures affect our ability to minimize solar heat gain? So, how do we go about testing that? Wigs on robots, obviously. Before anyone gets me, yes, technically this is not a robot. It's a thermal mannequin. What is a thermal mannequin? It is a nightmarish humanoid measuring device, where they made a clear decision to have the plugs go into the eye sockets. Like, do you see what I'm saying? Like, that is a choice. That is a design choice that was made. But these are great tools for measuring the performance of protective gear or clothing, and usually you do it in a climate-controlled chamber. Now, the thing about these thermal mannequins is they don't come cheap. They cost a pretty penny. Hundreds of thousands of pretty pennies. But that's why it's important to have rich friends as a scientist. And my lovely collaborators at Loughborough University in the UK happen to have one of these bad boys lying around. And they let me put wigs on it, which is really nice. But let's talk a little bit more about how mannequins work. How do they work? Well, it starts with the surface temperature. You set the mannequin's surface temperature to a certain setting, and if a item of clothing is not very insulating and the outside temperature is colder, it will take more electricity to keep that set surface temperature. However, if the outside temperature is warmer or you have a very insulating piece of clothing, then it will require less energy to keep that set surface temperature. So that is how we take all of those measurements and learn about the thermal properties of different fabrics. But instead, I decided to put wigs on it. Why not? It should work the same, right? So I decided what I was going to test. What we had to do was to find human hair wigs. And so I got a bunch of human hair wigs from the internet, of Chinese origin. All of them were 8 inches long, one of them was straight, one of them was artificially curled with moderately large curls, and the other one was artificially curled with very tight curls. Now, the reason I did this is we wanted to control as many variables as possible. And as I said before, humans are wonderful in the range of variation that they have in their hair. And hair varies in a lot of different aspects. You don't want to be dealing with all of those aspects in one experiment, so you want to hold as many variables constant as possible. And so by limiting and constraining our hairs from a particular source, and just making sure that the only difference was not length related, was just the curl size, we were relatively confident that the results we're getting are relating to our variable of curvature, so low, mid, and high curvature. But we also ran all of the experiments in the so-called nude condition. We looked at radiation, which we simulated with floodlights. That is what we're really interested in, right? Not just ambient temperature, because the way that heat transfer works in radiative heat is quite particular. We looked at a wind speed to simulate the effect of kind of standing still outside, of walking, and of running. And because we know that evaporative cooling and sweating is so important to humans, we also wanted to make sure that we looked at evaporation. So we ran all of the tests with the mannequin dry and with the mannequin scalp soaked wet so that we could understand about the evaporative cooling effect. And we simulated everything for 30 degrees Celsius, also known as 86 degrees Fahrenheit, because this is America. And now we're gonna look at figures, because science. Don't worry, guys, I got you. So, the legend over here with the different colors shows you the different head coverings that we use. So, orange on the top there is the nude, the green is low curve or straight, the blue is mid curve or moderately curly, and then the purple at the bottom is high curve or tightly curled. So, our x-axis here is the wind speed, and the y-axis is heat flux. Anything over zero means we have heat loss. That's what we're looking for, right? Anything under zero means we have heat gain. So let's ask, without solar radiation, what did we find in our experiments? Well, we found that there wasn't a lot of difference between the different hair textures. We could see that clearly you had more heat loss with the nude scalp. Okay, that's good. What about evaporative cooling without any solar radiation? Well, we just had that pattern exaggerated. We can clearly see that you can evaporate a lot more water off of your scalp if there's no barrier on it. And that increase that you see is what we would expect the more wind speed you have, the more that contributes to heat loss and evaporation. So what we're really interested in is solar radiation, so let's bring on those results. Completely different. Now you might panic for a second and think we're in the red zone, that's the danger zone. It is. As you can see, a nude scalp is well on its way to overheating, regardless of what wind speed we're talking about. And in fact, the only condition in which we're constantly at thermal balance, meaning we're not losing or gaining heat, is the high curve or tightly curled wig. And in fact, the tightly curled wig at the highest wind speeds is even losing heat. So that's fantastic. It's exactly what we wanted to see, even though we don't want to see things because we're scientists and we're objective and all that good stuff. Anyway, let's see how evaporative heat loss works with solar radiation. Uh-oh. Okay, well, it's back to what we had before. We see that it's reversed again. With solar radiation, again, we're seeing that having no barrier on the scalp means that you'll evaporate the most. Now, does this mean that our hypothesis needs to go in the trash? Not necessarily. Let's look at this another way. You may recall that I explained the way that we did evaporative heat loss. It was by running these experiments with a dry thermal mannequin scalp and then soaking the scalp. And as I say this, I realize I probably should have explained how we did that. So a thermal mannequin doesn't have skin, but you put a sort of cotton onesie all the way on it, and we soaked the scalp of that cotton onesie. That's obviously not how human sweat works, but we can still do some conversions so we can answer some more human-like questions. So we can ask, what was the maximum evaporative potential? What is the maximum amount of sweat that we could evaporate in any of these conditions per hour? Obviously, having no barrier on the scalp allows you to evaporate the maximum amount. But what's even more interesting is once we did our calculations and conversions, we saw the differences in the different hair texture. With straight hair, you can evaporate more sweat than you can with any of the different levels of curl. But sweat is not free. In nature, you do not just soak your scalp and like hope for the best. You have to actually work up that sweat and sweat it out. And for a hunting hominin, we're not just talking about water loss, we're talking about electrolyte loss, which, without Gatorade stations, can be a very dangerous thing. So what we really wanted to understand was, when we put it all together, for an ambient temperature of 30 degrees Celsius on a day with a lot of solar radiation, what is the minimum amount of sweat that is required to bring the body back to thermal balance so that it's no longer gaining heat? And what we see is that with tightly curled hair all the way at the bottom, you don't even need to sweat. You don't need to sweat at all. And while the nude condition allows you to evaporate the most amount of sweat, it also requires the most amount of sweat. So, to sum it all up, our results show that hair minimizes heat gain from solar radiation. We looked at no hair versus hair and found that in a lot of cases, having a barrier such as hair stops you from evaporating as much sweat as you could, and it stops you from losing as much heat as you could. However, in the context of radiation, you kind of want that barrier because you want to stop that radiation from generating heat on your scalp in the first place. What was also very exciting and never shown before is this correlation between increased hair curvature or higher curl and decreased solar heat gain, as well as a decreased need for sweating. So, what's next? Even though I enjoyed working with the Terminator-looking nightmare, I'm not much of an experimentalist. What I really want to do is some simulations. Because wouldn't it be cool to take all of this data that we've generated on thermal properties of different hair textures and plug it into an algorithm, as the kids do these days? We would be able to take all kinds of data, including paleoclimatic data, and try and answer questions about what hair texture would have been optimal for our evolutionary ancestors. That's one plus, but another plus is, with the right help, I could probably make an app so that you could plug in your variables and figure out what your next haircut should be. Then there's genetics. Now, I know I really opened this up by saying, hey, we found this impression of hair on skin from 164 million years ago. I want you to understand that that is rare. They got really lucky. Usually, soft tissue like hair and skin does not preserve. And so, the best way to get an evolutionary understanding of how things changed can be genetics. We can look at different modern human populations. And if we understand what genes are involved in hair morphology, we can look at the evolutionary history of those genes and ask, did natural selection shape any of them? Can we say that natural selection did anything for modern humans and even Neanderthals? Please ask me about Neanderthals. I love to talk about Neanderthals. But there are, of course, many more hair questions, like, do I have the cure for baldness? I don't. Otherwise, I would not be here before you today. I'd probably be on Mars. I will be answering all of those questions in my own lab starting this fall, so you can follow along with my research there. Thank you.